My next guest, Jonathan Antoine, rose to prominence after appearing on Britain's Got Talent back in 2012, where he and his singing partner Charlotte Giaconelli were runners-up. After two albums with Charlotte, they went their separate ways. Jonathan has released his new stunning debut solo album. It's called Tenore, and he joins me now. Good afternoon. Welcome, Jonathan.
Hello. It's a pleasure to be here.
Well, it's a pleasure to have you on the show.
Thank you.
There's a lot of love for you all over the world. I just want to read you a couple of things, actually, Jonathan, because I've had an email from Karen Jackson. Karen says, excited to hear Jonathan Antoine on your show, listening in from Dubai. And there will be fans listening in all around the world. Love to Jonathan from Karen. It doesn't end there. I'm going to read you this from Lynette Smith. Lynette says, hi, I'm sending this request from Canungra, a small dairy town in Queensland, Australia. It's almost 1 a.m. here, but I'm listening in to hear Jonathan. Jonathan has the finest voice to be heard in decades. Please, 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 will you play any song off his solo album, Tenore? Every song is spectacular, so it's hard to pick a favourite. And will you tell him, please, listen to this. This is personal to you. Lynette says, hiya, baby cakes. Thanks so much. I am only one of his biggest fans here down under. How does that make you feel? I mean, you have got the most incredible fans, haven't you?
Oh, they are incredible. I can't say anything that would justify how amazing all of these people have been to me over these 3 years, it has been now, roughly. And it just blows my mind, because I know all of these people's names, and I talk to them on a pretty much daily basis, and it's just incredible to be able to communicate and to build these incredible relationships with awesome people.
Jane Hyatt, she's another one that's listening. She's emailed me as well. She's in Birmingham, and also Kelly Noble Putt. She's a happy fan-twan listening to you and Jonathan today from London, Ontario, Canada.
Wow.
She says he's just amazing and we love him and his beautiful voice. Tenore is the most incredible CD. Thanks for having him on your show. Well, it's my absolute pleasure.
Well, it's my pleasure to be on here. Thank you.
Should we have a chat now? Should we do
that?
Yeah,
why not? Let's.
I think I could just read out the endless emails and tweets from all your fans from literally all around the world. But, I mean, did you ever think that as an aspiring opera singer that one day you would hold your own solo album in your hands?
Not in a million years, at least. I mean, it's all such a wild, wacky dream. I mean, not only does it exist, that's the first part, it even exists, but it's been on the official classical chart at number one for 3 weeks now, and it just blows my mind. I went into a studio and a church and recorded all these songs in the hopes that maybe some people would like them, and it's at number one on the classical chart.
And what you're doing, I think, as well, you know, you have all these wonderful fans, you know, young and old around the world, but what you're doing as well is igniting that enthusiasm for classical music and opera within a much younger audience, and that's quite something to be proud of, I think, Jonathan.
I mean, that is part of the main goal, yeah, most certainly, because people don't seem to be that interested in, like, the classic arts anymore, and particularly the younger generation, kind of my generation, I guess, really do need to kind of buckle down and save these arts, because they are incredible, and they're not, like, boring and stuffy, they're full of debauched madness and loads of fun.
We love a bit of debauched madness, especially on this show.
Of course.
But what sort of led you to be one of those people, those young, aspiring, perhaps opera stars, that actually fell hook, line and sinker for classical music?
I mean, all that really happened is I did singing lessons when I was 11 at high school. I started doing some soft musical theatre, like some Oliver, with my high voice. And from there, I just did a few classical pieces of repertoire, and I fell instantly in love. There was no spectacular story. It was just, I heard it, I sang it, and I felt it, and it was beautiful to me.
Did you aspire to be like, you know, any of the greats? I mean, we're talking Pavarotti, Placido Domingo, Jose Carreras. Did any of those particular opera stars inspire you?
Well, you've named the top three just there. It was in particular the three tenors that really, really inspired me. I mean, I heard a lot of my repertoire that I was learning at the start of my quote-unquote career done by the three tenors, and once you've heard them, there's not really anywhere to go from there except to try and put your own interest in it, I suppose.
Where does when you're singing one of these fantastic songs on the new album Tenore, where does it take you? Because it takes you, for me, to a higher universe than just singing a pop song.
Well, it's a strange question, because I'm completely present and in the room, and I am still very much there, but it's as if I'm observing the entire thing from above my own head. It's very strange. Like, I couldn't really explain it exactly, but it is almost spiritual, kind of very, as the doctor might say, wibbly wobbly timey wimey.
It's my kind of language. I mean, we have to doff our caps really to Britain's Got Talent, because perhaps, and I do say perhaps, you might not be here right now having this conversation with me had it not been for Simon Cowell.
No, I wouldn't, and I fully accept that. If I were to have found success, it would have been a much harder, much longer road, and I am incredibly grateful for the opportunities that I have had to experience and undergo.
How encouraging and nurturing has Simon Cowell been to you? Well, I mean, what advice has he given you?
He himself is unfortunately absent due to, you know, just being an incredibly busy man. But on the few occasions that I did meet him, he was an incredibly positive and actually sweet man. He, you know, obviously, what's on TV is on TV, but in the flesh, he's a kind man, I would have to say.
He's a pussycat.
Yeah, really.
He's a sheep in wolf's clothing.
Well, I mean, maybe there's like a wolf under the sheep as well. It's kind of a triple cross thing. I don't know.
Can you just describe what it was like? Because I think many of us remember that moment that you walked out on the Britain's Got Talent stage, and then suddenly, in a quite, I suppose, humble person walked out. Of course, there was Charlotte as well. But, you know, you look quite humble, and you never quite know what's going to come out of somebody's mouth when you watch that kind of programme. And when this massive voice, this incredible sound had come out of your mouth, just can you just describe that moment and what you felt from the audience?
Oh, man. that is another tough one. I stood up there, and you can't see the audience whatsoever because of the stage lights, but you can see the four judges really brightly illuminated, because obviously they're being filmed and they've got to have the camera lights on them and stuff. So it's very surreal. You see them and they look very far away, like dolls almost. And you stand up there and you kind of just... I blanked out personally. I just went, okay, I'm going to have to do this song and not, like, you know, defecate myself on stage. So I think I started the song slightly early because I was just like, okay, let's do it, let's go, can we please? So that kind of set me off on a weird foot, but then everyone started cheering and clapping, and I wanted to, like, start sobbing. I was so happy. It was... There are no words for something like that.
Your partner was Charlotte as well, and I mean, you've done two albums together, haven't you? And you've now gone your separate ways. And in fact, Charlotte's been on this show quite some time ago, and she spoke very lovingly about you. But you have said, and I read somewhere, that she makes you feel sick.
Whoa!
Can you explain that? Because you're still close, aren't you?
Yeah.
And you still speak and everything.
Mm-hmm. Where was this?
Do you know what? Maybe it was an interview that you'd done, you know, several months ago that has been taken out of context. But I just wondered why that was, because I know that you're very, very close. I mean, would there ever be an opportunity to record with Charlotte again?
I don't see why not. Obviously, it would have to be given a little bit of time. Obviously, we're trying to work as solo artists. I think that probably the interview was taken out of context, and it was probably something to do with me, like, fancying Charlotte, which I don't, personally.
Ah.
Yeah. No, I, no, it's a platonic thing.
Well,
but,
do you know what? I'm glad that I brought that out, because you've had the opportunity to actually put people straight.
I'd just put that out there. Yeah, clarify things.
There have been times. I mean, your life is going from strength to strength. We know that, Jonathan. You know, look at all the response that we've got just to this interview, actually, from around the world. But but there have been times in your life when things haven't been as good, and there have been dark times in your life.
Yes, indeed.
There were times when you didn't see a way forward.
No, not at all. This is what makes all of this all the more precious to me, personally. Because if this hadn't all happened, I don't know if... Not only would I not be sitting here doing this interview, I don't know if I would be here at all.
Mm.
So... It's
when you say that you don't know whether you would be here at all,
this planet, whatsoever.
What do you mean by
alive?
That? Was it that bad?
At the time, personally, because of course, when you're deep in that mindset, there is no way forward, and it's almost impossible to see light at the end of this horrific tunnel. And all I can advise to people who do feel that way is just to not focus on yourself, to attempt to cast that outwards and find help in other people.
Who really did help you?
I mean, it was a lot of my mum. She is the most fantastic woman, and my dad is an incredible inspiration to me. And of course, Charlotte, when both my sister and my singing partner, which is very funny, not the same person, but my sister is also called Charlotte. It's very confusing. They were both incredible just to have around. And I was very lucky in my particular situation to have an excellent support network in my family and my friends. And I'm lucky to have made it out of my dark times.
I think there are a lot of people now that you're helping out of dark times, and people are finding strength within your talent as well. I just want to read you another email. Shall I do another one?
Go for it.
Sheila Jenkins, Jonathan. She says this. I'm sure you know this already, but this amazing young man has the most incredible voice I've ever heard. It touches my soul like no other voice does. He is the total package, as he has the most beautiful soul as well. I'm not ashamed to say that he's changed my life. I love this young man very much. Thank you for letting me share this with you. And that, as I say, is from Sheila Jenkins. Now, let's now play, I think, a song from your new album, Tenore. What would you like us to play and why?
Well, first, I'd just like to say that was incredible, and thank you, Sheila. Secondly, I do like the song Core Ingrato, which is Ungrateful Heart, which is a very big, fun song, but it's very meaningful.
Well, I'm going to play it right now. This is from Jonathan Antoine's new album, Tenore. It's BBC Radio Oxford. We'll speak more after this.
Cut her.
The very stunning Core Ingrata. Jonathan, is that the correct pronunciation of that song?
Yes, indeed. Perfect pronunciation.
It's really, really easy to forget that you're just 19 years old.
Well, thank you.
Look, we're gonna keep our conversation going after this. We're just going to take some travel. So my guest this afternoon is Jonathan Antoine, and we will talk more after this. And my guest this afternoon is the very much loved, which is very apparent all around the world, Jonathan Antoine.
Hey.
So we've just heard Core Ingrato, and my inbox is completely crammed, actually. Got another one here. In fact, this is Sheila again saying, Core Ingrato, one of my favourites on the album. Thank you so much, Kat and Jonathan. So heartbreakingly beautiful. And Roger has also emailed and says, Roger here from Colorado and listening in on your show live from Colorado Springs. Hello, Jonathan, he says, your pal and friend always. Love the new album, Tenore. I'm wishing you all the best. And we could just not talk and I could just read you all the emails.
I'd be happy to sit and listen all day.
But actually, just going back to the... because that was a song that you actually wanted us to play this afternoon.
Yeah.
And done by Andrea Bocelli, Pavarotti... Mm. Russell Watson as well, who is a good friend of yours.
He is indeed. He is good buddy Russell. He's just been an absolute incredible help to me throughout my entire career so far. I mean, during the duo, I went up to his London apartment.
Oh, go on, what's it like?
Oh, it's so nice. I won't divulge too much information, but it's got a nice river view. It's spectacular. Oh, Very jealous.
You see, I think if I went to Russell Watson's apartment, I'd want to come go in the fridge and I'd want to go and look in his bedroom.
I was tempted, I must say. I wanted to have a little explore.
So how did that relationship, that friendship actually begin, Jonathan?
Oh, man. I did a gig at Live and Proms. I think it was 2 years ago now? And he was headlining, and we were essentially his support acts, and we came on at the end to do Pomp and Circumstance. Mm. And from there, I mean, obviously, because we were both around on the day, we sort of got talking very slightly. I mean, I was like, "You're Russell Watson, old man." And, yeah, it just kind of blossomed from there. And it's just an honour to be like a pally, and like I've got his number in my phone, and when, like, you know, people tend to ask you the question, who's the most famous person you've got on your phone, I've got Russell Watson. Yes.
You must have other celebrities in your phone now.
Not in particular. I think my roster is mainly Russell.
And you know where he lives, so you can send him a Christmas card as well.
he's on the list. Definitely.
Now, this album, Tenore, feels a dream of performing live, doesn't it, with an orchestra?
Oh, it's fun. A lot of fun.
Now you've ticked that box, though. You've done that. You've been there. You've worn the T-shirt. what is the next dream that you want to realise?
Depends how realistic you want me to be.
To be completely unrealistic. I really don't mind.
Well, completely unrealistic, I would like to go on a world tour followed by playing the first show on the moon before retiring at the ripe old age of 20.
I don't think, you see, the problem with that is it's not the moon, it's not the world tour, it's the fact that you want to retire at the ripe old age of 20 because your fans won't let you, Jonathan. I'm sure you of that.
Look, I have too much to do yet.
You certainly do, and I'm glad you've said that because your fans, as you know, are listening around the world to this very conversation.
I don't want to upset them.
So what does the next 12 months hold for Jonathan Antoine?
An awful lot, in fact. I'm throughout the month of November, particularly at the end, I've got a few really interesting gigs. I'm doing at the Royal Albert Hall for the Classical Spectacular, which is 6 concerts over 4 days, from the 20th to the 23rd of November. And following that, I'm also going to be at the Autumn Proms in the Southend at the Cliffs Pavilion on the 30th of November. Mm. Following this, with luck, because the album has now been released in America, there may be, possibly, don't get excited and run to computers all at once, please. There may be some promo in America, which would be huge. But apart from that, I'm just going to try and make as many people hear this album as possible. Mm.
Jonathan, it's been an absolute delight and a pleasure to have you on the show.
Oh, right back at you.
It really... Oh, I really ought to be down with the kids and, you know... right back at you. Okay, I got it. Right back at you.
You know, it's literal enough, I guess.
Look, you have got the most promising, fulfilling career. And yes, you are touching people with your absolutely exceptional voice as well.
Now, thank you.
As you know, there are people listening to this, your fans, all over the world right now. What would you like to say to your fans right now? The airways I'm giving them to you right now.
Each and every one of you are beautiful in your own special and specific way. There is nothing that anyone can do to harm you. You are an impenetrable shield of beauty, fun, laughter, happiness, sunshine and love. And I hope that everything always goes well for you in life at all times.
Back at you. Jonathan Brilliant. Antoine, thank you.
Thank you.